Welcome to worship at New Life Presbyterian Church. I'm Dwight Williams, pastor at New Life, and it's good to be worshiping with you. We want to thank everyone who helped serve yesterday at our Thanksgiving special community lunch food giveaway. We had a lot of helpers and we had a lot of food, and some of the stories we hear of people who have received the food is very heartwarming. And I want to thank all who have given and helped and made this happen. Our session, the Board of Directors, is meeting by Zoom this Sunday afternoon, and so we ask that you continue to keep our elders in your prayers. The session has voted not to hold worship services in our sanctuary yet, until the pandemic subsides and the gathering will be safe. The session asks that everyone take extra precautions to be safe during this difficult time, and we especially ask that you make wise plans for Thanksgiving. This pandemic is real. In the wake of the recent 2020 election, we ask that everyone be in prayer for our nation. Even though half of us may be relieved and happy with the results of the election, please realize that almost half of us are not happy with the election results. And so pray for peace and pray for understanding of the views of those across the aisle. If you are in need of pastoral help, you may call me or one of the elders, and their numbers are listed on the screen. New Life is trying to make a difference in our community, and we are a weekly collection point for community donations. If you would like to help others, we ask you to donate non-perishable food items. Plus, we are receiving toilet paper and paper towels, and those items may be dropped off between noon and 1 on Mondays. To all who are weary and seek rest, to all who mourn and long for comfort, to all who sin and need a Savior, to all who hunger and thirst after righteousness, to all who would serve the living God, to all who rejoice that God through Christ Jesus has brought them salvation and abundant life, welcome in the name of Christ. Let us now recall our mission statement. We believe we are called to be a congregation of diverse backgrounds, ages, and races, bound together by the love of God as God's servants, partners, and missionaries in sharing God's love. We believe we are called to be a sign of hope in our community, to bring new life to the world, and to give our lives as a channel of the Holy Spirit, providing spiritual leadership in the community and involving others in caring for God and neighbors. We believe we are called to be preachers and doers of God's Word through worship, study, fellowship, and involvement in and for all, both here and worldwide. Let us join in our call to worship and opening prayer. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. We gather to worship Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. We come to sing praises and shout for joy. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. We come to lay down our burdens and to accept freedom in Christ. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. We come to renew ourselves for service as followers of Jesus. Let us pray together. O Redeemer God, as we gather in worship on this Sunday, we ask that you send your Holy Spirit to fall afresh on us. We pray for your Spirit to awaken new hope in us. Grant us the vision to see the coming of your kingdom. Help us to celebrate the glimpses of grace that you have given to each of us. Knit our hearts together in worship so that we know we do not struggle alone in working for your peace and justice. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is Christ the King Sunday, and so both of our scriptures have something to do with kingship and God. Listen to our scripture from Jeremiah 23, verses 1 through 6. "Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture," says the Lord. "Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings," says the Lord. "Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold. And they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them. And they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing," says the Lord. "The days are surely coming," says the Lord, "when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. On this week before Thanksgiving, we are also celebrating the last Sunday before Advent begins. Advent is a four-week time of preparation for the coming of Jesus, the Messiah. So, before we enter this solemn and reflective season of Advent and begin to prepare for the coming of Christ, we have one final blowout, that is Christ the King Sunday. Today we proclaim Jesus King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so this New Testament account of Jesus before Pontius Pilate is especially appropriate. Listen for God's word. "Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, 'Are you the King of the Jews?' Jesus answered, 'Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?' Pilate replied, 'I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?' Jesus answered, 'My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here.' Pilate asked him, 'So you are a king?' Jesus answered, 'You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.'" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Pontius Pilate is a governor, a Roman governor, and he understands power and hierarchy. That's one of his big problems with his territory, Judea. Most of the known world has been conquered by the Roman Empire, but these people in Judea are stubborn. They refuse to bow to the Roman emperor. The children of Israel refuse to worship this Roman king. And instead, they worship their own god. They are stubborn. So Pontius Pilate knows that he has to take strong action, something that will put these people in their place once and for all. And there's extra trouble brewing with a man named Jesus. He is a leader, he is drawing huge crowds, and he is polarizing. Some people love him, and some people hate him. But public unrest is not what the Roman Empire wants. The Roman peace, the Pax Romana, is super important. And these rebellious Jews are giving Pilate a black eye in the view of his superiors. So, with the help of the religious opposition, Pilate takes Jesus into custody. Few beatings to soften him up. And Pontius Pilate interrogates Jesus using the only terminology he knows: kingship, power, hierarchy. Pilate asks, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" So Pilate tries again. "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own chief priests and people handed you over. What have you done?" Jesus responds, My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me safe. But my kingdom is not from here. Pilate screams, "So you are a king!" Jesus quietly says, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." And Pilate's head is about to explode. So Pilate finally throws up his hands and says, "Whatever. You can be whatever you want to be. But I'm going to use the power that I have, and it will put a stop to you and your upside-down ideas." And Pilate does. Lindy Black, she's a high school science teacher and a Methodist pastor. And on her website, she has the story of a different kind of king. It's called King Backward. Here's the story. Once upon a time, a long time ago, there lived a king. This is no ordinary king. He is different from other kings because he does everything backwards from the way other kings do them. From the very day he is born, you can tell that this king is going to be different. Most kings are usually born in a palace, but this king was born in a stable surrounded by donkeys and sheep and cows. Not a very big beginning for a king. In fact, at King Backward's birth, very few people even know that a king has been born. Only a handful of shepherds and some wise men get the word that a king has been born. As the infant king grows into a man, he continues to be different from other kings. While most kings spend all of their time building up riches of silver and gold and jewels, this king owns nothing at all. And while most kings surround themselves with servants, King Backward chooses to be a servant. He can often be found helping others. As time goes on, people become very unhappy with their king because he just doesn't act the way they think kings should act. Instead of riding into town on a big white horse the way other kings do, their king rides into town on the back of a donkey. And the people he chooses to be his friends, his closest friends are a bunch of smelly fishermen, and he often hangs out with the poor and eats with sinners. People finally decide that they have put up with this backwards king long enough. If he can't act the way a king should act, then they don't want him to be their king anymore. They make a plan to have him arrested and thrown into prison. And their plan works. When the day of his trial comes, the king stands before the people, and instead of shouting, "Hail to the king! Long live the king!" instead they shout, "Crucify him! He is not our king! Crucify him!" So, they crucify their king. They nail him to a cross. Instead of a crown of gold and jewels, they put on a crown made of thorns on his head. They poke him with sharp sticks and make fun of him. What a way for a king to die. After he is crucified, they take his body and put it in a borrowed tomb. But that isn't the end of the story. God raises King Backward from the grave to live forever. So instead of being backward king, he is now forever king. He is the king to anyone who chooses him to be their king. Oh, there are still some people who call him King Backward. But those who know him don't call him that. They call him King Jesus. Jesus wants to be your king, too. Isn't that a great story? Kings who are usually full of bluster and force and power. This King Jesus comes to us with an invitation. This King Jesus comes quietly, with a refreshing splash of water, with a taste of bread and wine. I wonder if we're committing a bit of heresy when we say the Apostles' Creed, because we say, "And he is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and he will come to judge the living and the dead." According to the Apostles' Creed, Jesus finally wins with supreme power and muscle. which is exactly the opposite of what Jesus teaches and lives out on earth. The reign of Christ Jesus is power from the bottom, shown through relationship and steadfast love and never-ending, constant devotion. So come, let us worship our King, who comes to us with love and life-giving peace and joy. Amen. Let us now turn our hearts to God in prayer. O God, on this day of giving thanks, we praise you for the gifts that you have lavished upon us, for warm sunlight, for cleansing rain, for the change of seasons, we give you thanks. For friendship and food and laughter, we give you thanks. For food and family, and for the lives of meaning and purpose that we can have, we give you thanks. For forgiveness when we fail, and for cleansing and rebirth, we give you thanks. Our lives are rich with your abundance. We now raise up our prayers for those who struggle to lift hands in gratitude. We pray for nations embroiled in war. We pray for refugees. We pray for innocent civilians. We pray for soldiers. And we lift up those whose souls are tortured by violence and despair. We pray for those near and far who cannot put enough food on the table to feed their families. We pray especially for children who cannot run and play and learn and grow because of food insecurity. We pray that we might generously give to them from our abundance. We pray for our leaders, elected, appointed, and those who have positions of power in the business community and in our neighborhoods. We pray that they may be wise and tough and generous. We pray that they might lead in ways that give glory to your name. We pray for our friends and family and neighbors. We especially pray for those who are struggling with hurt and pain, those with financial stresses, those with illness or disease. And especially at this time, we pray for doctors and nurses and medical workers. We pray for teachers, missionaries, students. We pray for parents and for children. God, this world is an amazing combination of blessing and woe, of joy and sorrow. So give us faith to see your hand at work in the world. Give us courage to act in ways that bring about your kingdom in our midst. And give us hope to never give up. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Hear now our charge and benediction. The week ahead holds hours and days that are gifts from God's hand. They're given to each of us. So go out into this world of richness as disciples who make a difference. Be messengers of peace. Be workers for justice and welfare. Be bringers of good news and examples of God's self-giving love in the world. Go out in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.